crude. So, and it's around 315, so perhaps we should take a sharp break of about 328. Someone may want to hear it.
Today's afternoon session. This list is number 56. DENAX zeolite catalyst for normal paraffin dehydrocyclization. Tracer studies. This is by Geoffrey Price and Joe Hightower, representing the Department of Chemical Engineering, Rice University. And the presentation will be made by Joe Hightower.
Thank you very much. It's a real privilege for me to be here today. I bring greetings from the Southwest Regional Meeting, which will be held in a couple of weeks in Houston. So I wish you the best up here for the Southeast. I don't know which meeting I'm in. Actually, yesterday I was at the AICHE meeting in Miami. And so I have to ask, this is Tuesday. Must be doing that. Now, I would like to thank Bert for inviting me to come, and I hope that the lecture will be useful to some people. Let's begin by having the first slide. Yeah. I think we can see this without having to turn the lights down. I've also asked that Gethard Eric hand out copies of most of the material that I'll be presenting. Is there anyone who doesn't have a copy of that? If you see that people get that thing. This way, you'll at least have something to take home with you. I'll be talking about tellurium sodium zeolites used in the dehydrocyclization of normal paraffins. Now, why do we want to do this? Well, already, Tom has mentioned octane, and in fact, we still are interested in improving octanes, and one way of doing it is by upgrading normal paraffins, which have extremely low octanes on their own, as we all know. You can improve their octanes in at least two ways. One is by isomerizing it. That does some good. In fact, it does a lot of good. But an even better way is to turn these normal paraffins into aromatics. And that's what we'll be talking about today, and that is the incentive for doing this. Also, normal paraffins are rather difficult materials in the deep stream to do too much with. And so it turns out that several years ago, Mobile Research Development found that if one used tellurium sodium zeolite, that these were excellent catalysts for this particular reaction. Support came from NSF, Robert and Welch Foundation. We had some solid state NMR done by people from Exxon, very cool shell development estimate. And one of the people named Sinper Ismagilov from the Institute of Catalysis in Nova Spears was also a postdoctoral in our lab for a while and did some cyclohexane work. Geoffrey Price is my primary co-author, who is now at LSU. Okay, the objectives of this work then were to look at the selectivities for converting the normal paraffins, C6 and larger, into aromatic. We wanted to investigate the reaction pathways, and one of the questions that we had was, are intermediates in the formation of the aromatics olefins or perhaps cyclohexane? These two issues will be dealt with. We'll take a look at the kinetics, perhaps a bit about the mechanism and what is the rate limiting step of some of these reactions, and finally a bit about the structure of the catalyst. Now, let's begin with the latter. What is the catalyst? How do we get it? Well, one begins with the simply sodium X, 13 sodium X zeolite, and mixes it with anywhere from 3 to 15% tellurium metal. This material is then ball milled for a few hours, then it's pelleted, ground and sieved to about somewhere around 40 mesh material, and this is what was used in all of our work then as the catalyst. Activation. You simply take this ball mill material and flow hydrogen over it at high temperature in the range of 500 to 540 degrees centigrade for several hours, and lo and behold, it becomes the catalyst. So that's the material that we're working with in all cases. The reaction conditions, we actually use two, but primarily they were carried out in a flow system at one atmosphere pressure in the temperature range 400 to 540 centigrade. The hydrocarbon was either in hydrogen or in a hydrogen helium carrier gas. And we have hydrocarbons concentration in the range of 0.2 to 2 moles per liter and a space time of about 0.1 to 2 seconds. That's the contact time of the catalyst. So we're talking about fairly fast reactivity under these conditions. The products were almost exclusively aromatics. Now, the flow reactor itself simply had the hydrogen coming in or hydrogen-helium mixture. A flow meter, we could add the liquid hydrocarbons over here that were hexane, heptane, octane, etc. With a syringe pump, these were then mixed and sent through the reactor and collected in a sample loop for chromatographic analysis. And for using isotopic tracers, we had a doser where we could put pulses over the catalyst and then collect. Now, let's look at what happens to the tellurium. Remember, in some cases, we started out with as much as 15 weight percent tellurium. Turns out it's not very stable. And this is one of the reasons this catalyst is not in commercial use today, is because tellurium leaks out or bleeds out of the catalyst. And if one keeps this in hydrogen and flows the hydrogen through at about 500 degrees centigrade, you'll slowly lose it down to about 3 weight percent tellurium. At that point, it will remain relatively stable for days, with as long as you keep hydrogen in the gas phase. However, if you replace the hydrogen with helium, very quickly, almost all of the tellurium is lost. And therein lies the problem. Tellurium, tellurium hydrides in particular, are very toxic, and I don't think the refineries are interested in getting these out of the environment, nor would I want to live around. So that's one of the difficulties. However, if you do keep the hydrogen present, they are stable. Now, temperature, that's those were about 500 degrees centigrade. Now, so on the one hand, we have to keep at least half an atmosphere or so of hydrogen present to keep this catalyst stable. But look what happens to the reaction rate as we have too much hydrogen. Now here's the partial pressure of hydrogen in atmospheres going from one atmosphere up to about 10. Here's our reaction rate for the benzene production from normal hexane. Notice that the higher the hydrogen pressure, the lower the benzene, the rate of the reaction. So we're sort of caught in a bind. In fact, we can even go to lower than one atmosphere pressure. Here we're starting at about one atmosphere would be over this side. And then coming down again as we drop the pressure to like half an atmosphere or less, the rate still continues to climb. So this was at 540 degrees centigrade. Now, let's look at the first bit of kinetics and see what the reaction pathways may be. Now, one possibility, if we start with hexane, which is labeled as capital H, we may possibly have hexene, which is the H dash, form as an intermediate. Then the hexene may go on to dehydrogenate, dehydrocyclize, form benzene. And if we just simply examine the reaction products here as we change the space-time or the reciprocal space velocity, notice that at low conversions, we have a dominance of the olefin hexenes being formed. These turn out to be a thermodynamically equilibrated mixture of normal hexenes. And then these decrease as the benzene product comes up. This is a classical A to B to C reaction. So it does look like the hexene is in fact serving as an intermediate, and we first have the dehydrogenation step, then further dehydrogenation and cyclization. But let's look at that a little bit more closely by using some radioactively labeled compounds. We might put in the radioactively labeled hexene and see what happens. The next slide will simply look at the material. No, this is another slide. It's just like the other one, only with different concentrations of hexane. And notice that all of these curves are fairly similar. And and that implies that we have first order reactivity. Because if it were strictly first order, all of these curves at all different pressures would be identically the same, and they're pretty close. So it's first order or slightly less than first order in Hexene. Now, let's investigate the possibility of the Hexene being an intermediate. In this case, we began with a mixture containing about 60% hexane, 40% hexene. This was one hexane. And in this case, we're simply plotting over here the mole fraction versus the contact time. This is now done in a batch reactor where we're measuring time in minutes over a very small amount of catalyst at about 460 degrees centigrade. First of all, notice that there is an increase initially in the reactant hexane. That coincides with a rapid decrease in the hexene, which means that not only do we have the reactions possibly illustrated here, but we may have the hexene going back into the hexane. So we may have an equilibrium type situation here. Now let's look what happens at the radioactivity in these various species as we go across in time. If all of the benzene were formed from the hexene label, we should have the same radioactivity in the benzene product as we have in the hexene. On the other hand, if we have some leakage directly bypassing the hexene, going from hexane to benzene, we should have a lower radioactivity in the benzene than we have in the hexane, indicating that it's formed from both the radioactive and the non-radioactive pathway. So the next slide shows the results. And if you'll notice over here that the benzene, which is these triangles, solid triangles, and the hexene are both almost the same. In fact, the benzene even has slightly higher specific activity. But notice that the hexane, unreacted, also begins with zero radioactivity and comes up, and of course all of these curves will have to come together at infinite time. But it looks like that we do indeed have a rapid equilibration between the hexane and the hexene, and then the hexene goes on downstream, and we do not have direct interconversion from hexane to benzene bypassing the gas phase hexene. This is shown in another experiment in which instead of labeling the hexenes, we labeled the hexane, and again had a mixture that contained about, let's see, this was 50 torr of hexane and 8 torr of the hexene molecules. But the point here is that the radioactivity in the hexane remained, it decreased slightly as we had some reversible nature here of the hexane, which is non-radioactive. So that fell off a little bit. But the point to notice is that both the hexene and the benzene went through zero specific activity, indicating that the benzene was not formed directly from the initially radioactive hexane. It was formed from the initially non-radioactive hexene. Now we can draw next we can take another look here. Another possibility is that we may have the hexene now perhaps cyclizing to form cyclohexane, which then they dehydrogenate to form benzene. Now no cyclohexane was formed that we could see, but still maybe there was some very small amount formed, and we could look at this by using the radioactively labeled materials. So what we did here was to begin with a mixture that contains about 12 torr of cyclohexane and 50 torr of radioactive hexene 1. And we wanted to see if indeed there were any radioactivity in cyclohexane. Now, we back up to say that if we started with cyclohexane by itself, this reaction would go very nicely and rapidly over the catalyst. But what we're doing now in this experiment is introducing the cyclohexane that was not present initially. We want to see what kind of perturbation this has. Well, I think the thing to notice here is that the specific activity or the radioactivity in the cyclohexane remain, for all practical purposes, zero. So that means that there was no direct interconversion of the radioactive hexane into the cyclohexane, even though cyclohexane did itself form benzene. So this pathway over here must be ruled out. Now the next slide, I think, shows the overall scheme now, beginning with normal hexane, which we believe is in equilibrium with the hexenes, normal hexenes, which are again all in equilibrium with each other. We do not have any direct interconversion between the hexane and the cyclohexane, or the hexene and the cyclohexane. Those two pathways are ruled out in the radioactive experiments. Probably what happens is there is another dehydrogenation to form hexadiene and hexatriene, which then rapidly can non-catalytically, homogeneously, as was shown by Lewis and Snyder 30 years ago or so, form cyclohexadiene, which then can dehydrogenate or finally our product benzene. If we deliberately introduce some cyclohexane, then it can be dehydrogenated first to the ene, the diene, and finally the benzene. So the thing that I think we have shown in these experiments is that these pathways here do not exist. Now, let's take a look, though, at the cyclohexane reaction a little bit further. We wanted to try to see what the mechanism was and what was the rate limiting step in the cyclohexane reaction going to benzene plus hydrogen. Well, we wondered about the involvement of the hydrogen in the gas phase. We thought, let's carry out the experiments in the presence of hydrogen and in the presence of deuterium gas and see if there's any difference. And it turns out, as you can tell over here, this is the log of the fraction of conversion versus time. This is the first order reaction plot, that in both cases, the data point superimposed, indicating that there is no isotope effect, that the gas, hydrogen, and deuterium apparently was not involved in, or activation of that was not involved in the rate-limiting step. But there's another thing. In going from cyclohexane to benzene, we obviously have to lose about six hydrogen atoms. So cleavage of carbon-hydrogen bonds must be involved in the reaction. Maybe that could be rate-limiting. So we thought we could now take either hydrogen or deuterium gas and have a mixture of hydrogenated cyclohexane and unhydrogenated or fully deuterated cyclohexane and compare their rates. Actually, they've done several experiments. And here, here, notice that in the cyclohexane with deuterium, we have a slower reaction rate than the cyclohexane with hydrogen, H12. And so this isotope effect is in the order of 2 or 2.5. In fact, it's 2.44 in this experiment, which is a large primary kinetic isotope effect, which indicates the cleavage of the carbon-hydrogen or carbon-deuterium bonds is, in fact, rate-limited. Now let's go back and look what happens, though, if we carry this out in the presence of deuterium gas using the lightweight cyclohexane. There was, in fact, incorporation of a little bit of deuterium into the benzene product, even though we're losing six hydrogen atoms and going from here to here. There is also, at the same time, the addition of about one deuterium atom. This function over here is simply the number of deuterium atoms per benzene molecule or per cyclohexane molecule. Notice there was almost no exchange with cyclohexane, but the benzene seemed to pick up one deuterium atom. I don't know what that means. We have tried to figure out a mechanism that will account for this, and so far it failed. But it does mean that even though the net reaction is towards dehydrogenation, we do pick up one deuterium atom per molecule on the average in the reaction product. Now, these isotope effects here and carry the reaction out at different temperatures than 400 degrees centigrade, we'll see that we can get an activation energy for the deuterated material and for the hydrogenated material. But the difference between those gives us a difference in the kinetic activation energy of about 2.8 kilocalories per mole, which is about what one would expect for the cyclohexanoid cleavage of a carbon-deuterium bond. So this all is perfectly consistent with the rate-limiting step being on cleavage. Oh, yes. Yes. And in fact, these are, in fact, you can even tell from the data points here, these points really are reproducible within about 1%. It's amazing. And here we have a difference of approximately 2.5, factor 2.5. If you take the least squares of those lines, I don't remember the numbers, but it's out in the decimal point somewhere that you have an uncertainty. So I think that they are most certainly meaningful. It may not be exactly 2.8, but I'll bet you it's more than 2.0. Okay, what about the kinetics? Well, we've already shown that the reaction in the case of the normal hexane, here we're talking about cyclohexane. The cyclohexane is first order in cyclohexane concentration. It's also inverse first order in hydrogen. This again is consistent with the removal of hydrogens being a part of the reaction. We're going towards a more dehydrogenated species. So we might expect to have higher the pressure of the hydrogen, the slower would be the reaction rate. And that can be modeled. The reaction rate is not affected by the presence of benzene. We have added benzene to the reaction stream. Find that it does not influence the rate to any significant degree. So if we believe then that we have a cyclohexane being dehydrogenated to the hexane, to the hexadiene, combined with benzene, and we write a steady state on the two hexane and hexadiene species, and by going through the mathematics, we come out with a rate for cyclohexane dehydrogenation that is first order in cyclohexane, and it turns out that you have a square term in hydrogen here, and a hydrogen to the first power term in the denominator. And the relative sizes of the A1 and the A2 relative to the 1 will give us roughly an inverse order, maybe anywhere up to second order inverse in the partial pressure of hydrogen. And again, that's true because we have a dynamic equilibrium established involving these species during the reaction pathways. Okay, so again, this is kind of a summary to this point, involving the C6 species. We start off with hexane, does not go to cyclohexane, but it does go to the enes. The enes do not go to cyclohexane, but they go on these products down here and write the rate equation that predicts the observations. Finally, then, a non-homogeneous or non-catalytic homogeneous process going to cyclohexadiene, which then dehydrogenates. So what is the role then of the tellurium? Well, I really think that the tellurium present in this catalyst is simply acting as a dehydrogenation species. Because here we have dehydrogenation. Then we could account for this by a homogeneous, then dehydrogenation again. And that is what the tellurium does. And we'll come back to that in just a little bit. But let's switch now from the C6 to the C7, normal heptane. You'll notice here that if we carry out measuring the fraction of the molecules, the hydrocarbon molecules that are present as something, you'll see that we do have some benzene being formed. That means that we're cracking off a methyl group. But far and away, the largest material formed is toluene. And if you add these two together, we're talking about almost 100% of the heptane going through aromatics. you're causing or venting. I should add that we also obtained methane, which accounted for the benzene score here. Now, in toluene, there are several different ways that we can form toluene, but the most obvious way to do it is if we have a normal heptane, is to have either 1-6 closure or 2-7 closure. So to make sure that that is what was happening with this catalyst, we took some heptane that was labeled with carbon-14 in the 1 position. Now, if we have the 1-6 closure, the carbon-14 should be in the ring position alpha to the point where the methyl group is attached. If, on the other hand, we had 2-6-2-7 closure, then the radioactivity should be in the methyl position. And so by taking our reaction products over here and decomposing the toluene and comparing it, the benzene that was left over after chopping that off but we find that approximately 50% of the carbon was either in the 1 position of the ring or in the methyl group. So this does, I think, confirm that the simplistic mechanism is, in fact, the way in which this material is formed. So it probably, first of all, dehydrogenates, then 1,6 or 2,7 dehydrocyclizes, then dehydrogenates further form the product. These were carried out in a recirculation reactor and at about 85% conversion. And this was the way we actually converted the toluene into phenylbromide and eliminated the methyl group factor. Now let's move on from the C7 to the C8 species. The C8 species now, by having the same 1,6 or 2,7 or now 3,8 closure, we should get either ethylbenzene or orthoxylene, both of which were formed. The stars represent the orthoxylene and the closed circles the ethylbenzene. Now, if we lop off or remove a methyl group, we'll have toluene, which was here, so there's a significant amount of toluene form, and finally, if we lose 2 methyl groups, there's a significant amount of benzene form. So all of those would be accounted for. What was significant is that there was no metaxylene or paraxylene form, an undetectable amount. So this again, I think, confirms very nicely the 1,6, 2,7, 3,8. Now, let's get back to the catalyst, the tellurium zeolite catalyst, and take a look at what happens to the tellurium. Well, these were some ESCO results in which we looked at various species, we looked for the binding energies, the relative number of atoms that we have, comparing the zeolite alone with the zeolite containing the tellurium. And I think the point to notice here is that with the tellurium, and you can't read this, it was off in the drawer, but this should be tellurium plus 4, and this is tellurium 0. So we have the tellurium present both as a plus 4 ion and in the 0 beta state. Now when this thing was sitting in the ESCO machine for a little while being bombarded, we found that the TE plus 4 dropped to 0 after a few minutes and half an hour of radiation in the ESCO machine. However, we did not see a corresponding growth of the TE0. And that's rather embarrassing because you see it disappear in one place, not the other. What that probably means is that the ESCO machine, XPS machine, the Shell development company, still has tellurium all over it. I'm sorry for that. So if we have them analyze the things that tellurium, it's probably out. But, anyway, we think that it would be blasted completely out of the material. We do have the tellurium present in those 2 states in the initial material. Another thing that was done was to look at the NMR spectra of the tellurium and sodium hexaelide, and then the sodium hexaelide got the tellurium. And the point to notice here is that when the sodium X is present without the tellurium, then we have a peak over here that's significantly to the left of zero. Now, when the tellurium is present, either in activated in deuterium or hydrogen, and I might mention this is sodium NMR, this peak is shifted from here down near zero in both cases. And so it looks like that the introduction of tellurium, even though we have a relatively small amount of tellurium present to it, in comparison to the sodium, is enough to shift the sodium NMR spectrum. And that probably means then that we have a complex of some type that involves the tellurium and the sodium on the surface acting in the catalytic mode and forming the active sites. I mentioned that dehydrogenation, we think, is the role of the tellurium. Let's look at this a little bit more closely. If we take any of the hydrocarbons that we've been talking about now, and as this molecule approaches the tellurium, we can have a complex form of this nature, which will then become dehydrogenated and form a tellurium dihydride. Then the hydrogen, of course, can be eliminated as H2. Now, do you have any evidence for that? The evidence, I think, is shown on the next slide, where we are trying to adsorb hydrogen and measure the amount of hydrogen that the tellurium will take up. And you'll see here that this is an isobar where we have approximately one atmosphere of hydrogen per gram of catalyst. We're measuring now the hydrogens adsorbed as a function of temperature. Notice that at low temperature there's not too much adsorbed, but this goes up into a maximum. And the maximum up here at 6 cc's SPP corresponds approximately to 2 hydrogen atoms for each tellurium that's in the sample. So that tells us, if we believe this model, two things. One, that all of the tellurium is in fact available for adsorption of hydrogen. And secondly, that it does, each one, adsorb 2 hydrogen atoms. Now, there are other interpretations that you can put on that. The numbers are rather intriguing, and I think are fairly strong evidence that we do have a dihydride being formed. So, if I could conclude then with the statements, we do believe that the tellurium sodium hexaelide is highly selective for taking normal paraffin aromatics. It's selective primarily because the sodium is there to block the acid sites. We do not have isomerization, skeletal isomerization taking place. The olefinic isomerization is extremely rapid, but skeletal isomerization does not occur to any significant degree. That's what we meant here, no skeletal isomerization or cracking. We did have some hydrocracking in the formation of the methyl, of methane, where we have carbon numbers larger than C6. Olefins are definitely intermediates in these reactions. Cyclohexane is definitely not an intermediate, even though cyclohexane can form the aromatic toxins. Catalyst promotes dehydrogenation, probably by the formation of a dihydride on the surface. Cyclization may, possibly, and probably, is a gas-based reaction of the hexatriene, although we cannot rule out this happening on the surface. I simply mentioned that Lewis and Steiger have shown many years ago that at much lower temperatures than we're using, this reaction did occur in the gas phase, so it could occur. Rate limiting step apparently is carbon hydrogen bond cleavage. Tellurium forms the dihydride, and the tellurium and sodium may form a chemical complex that results in the active salts. So those are the things that I wanted to say about this particular reaction. Now, just in closing, I might mention that a totally different subject, that one of my functions is to serve on the ACS Petroleum Research Fund Advisory Board. I'm chair of that board. That's the organization that makes the decision about who gets petroleum research fund money. And I've just come come from Miami, where I've talked about this to the chemical engineers. And if any of you academic people here would be interested in some information about the PRM, I have that with me, and I have some material that you can take home with you if you would like to have it. So that's a parting shot. So thank you very much for your attention.